John, I'm stuck section, and I'll try to answer them as I do the presentation, or if it's something more complicated, maybe at the end, but I'll try to do it through the presentation. That way we can do things more efficiently. So this webinar is on PMP compliant measurements using CPCs. And basically the webinar concentrates on the CPC itself and not the complete measuring system. And basically the webinar is more geared through the proper calibration of a CPC so that you can do compliant measurements for engine emissions. So outline of the webinar, basically where CPCs are used in engine testing applications, what are the requirements for CPC according to PMP for type approval. That's the main focus of the presentation. We'll talk about current and upcoming 10 nanometer regulations and how the requirements have changed. And then we'll talk about the specific calibrations that TSI offers for the engine exhaust CPCs, and also for reference counters in the case that you are interested in having your own calibration set up or verification set up, and you want to do this type of calibrations yourself where you need a reference CPC. And then we'll also talk about our new 17025 accredited calibrations applicable to engine exhaust CPCs. So CPCs are used in a variety of engine applications. The main one is the type approval testing. And this is applicable to light duty vehicles and heavy duty engines and regulations 49 and 83. And also the global technical regulation 15 has the same regulation in terms of measurements done with CPCs. So those of regulations share the same requirements. Second application is for in-use or real driving emissions for light and heavy duty vehicles. And for those applications, the equipment is more portable, and but still there are there's instrumentation that is used for real driving emissions under Euro 6 regulations that use CPC as the particle number concentration measurement instrument. A third application is measuring solid particle concentration on non-growth mobile machinery. And for example, we have the NPAT, which complies with the Swiss regulation for doing that. And finally, a newer application for CPCs is a periodic technical inspection of vehicles. And as you know, there are new regulations coming into play. Already the Netherlands has a regulation on PTI. And so these portable instruments can also be based on CPC technology. For type approval systems, you have a solid particle counting system, which is comprised of several components. So in this case, in the figure, you can see a CVS tunnel from which you take your any exhaust sample. It goes through a cyclone to remove any large particles coming from either the engine or from the tunnel. And then you go through a dilution system comprising heated diluter, followed by evaporation tube to remove any volatile or semi-volatile particles. After that, you go through a second dilution. And finally, from there, you go to the CPC, or which is referred to the PNC, particle number counter. And that CPC has specific requirements according to PMP, which I'm sure all of you are familiar with it. This CPCs has very specific requirements on how it should work. Most important, it needs to be a full flow CPC with a response time of less than 5 seconds. And a counting accuracy in the current PMP requirements of plus minus 10% with respect to a traceable particle number standard, with a counting resolution of 0.1 particles per cc. You can also have a counting efficiency and concentration reported with a calibration factor. We'll explain a little bit where it comes from. And these CPCs have specific requirements for counting efficiency at different sizes, and that's in the next slide. So for the current regulations for Euro 6 regulations, they're still at 23 nanometers, for which the CPC needs to have efficiency of 50 plus minus 12%. And for 41 and higher, more than 90%. For the upcoming Euro 7 regulations, the CPC, we're going down to 10 nanometers, and the requirement, the current requirement, it's not final regulation yet, but there's a draft for it, and the requirement is 65 plus minus 15% at 10 nanometers, and more than 90% for 15 nanometers and higher. These CPCs can be calibrated with either emery oil or soot generated by a cast or a mini cast. Here at TSI, we use emery oil. You can see on the right, typical counting efficiency curve for both types of CPCs. And you can see that for the new 10 nanometer CPCs, the efficiency curve is sharper. And that's just because of the way CPCs work. You typically get a sharper response with respect to size when you go to lower cut points. Because at 23 nanometers, the delta T between the condenser and saturator and the CPC is pretty small, and that leads to this less steep counting efficiency curve. In addition to the counting efficiency in the steep part of the curve, these CPCs need to have their concentration linearity checked, and that's typically done at six different concentrations in the single particle counting mode. And the calibration factor for this linearity curve should be between 0.9 and 1.1, and this linearity factor is reciprocal of the linearity slope. One important thing to remember is that for the upcoming Euro 7 regulations and for 10 nanometer CPCs, after using the calibration factor, the requirement for the concentration agreement between the CPC and the reference counter is 5%. In this plot, we have the typical linearity curve for a 23 nanometer CPC. In this case, it's 3790A from TSI. And you can see for the current regulations, the typical range for CPC is only up to 10,000 particles per cc. In reality, CPC can measure higher concentrations, but there is a limit as to the coincidence factor that can be applied to the measurements. And so it needs to be below 10%. So that's why there is also a limit on the upper range of the concentration. But you can see here a very linear performance, typical of CPCs with R square value of nearly perfect of one. And in this case, the slope of 0.9524. And the reciprocal of that is 1.05. That's the K factor for the CPC. And then on the table, you can see that once you apply that K factor to the CPC measurements, the error between the reference and the CPC being calibrated is, in this case, at below 1%. In the case of a 10 nanometer CPC, you have here a typical calibration curve. This is for a 3790A-10. And you can see that we increase the concentration range from 10,000 all the way to 50,000 particles per cc. And you can see again that the correlation is perfectly linear with R square of one and a slope of 0.997, which nearly a K factor of almost perfect of one. In this case, this calibration is done against electrometer because doing with CPC would require to have a ultra fine CPC with a very small cut point. So for the calibration setup, what we use at TSI is we follow the ISO standard 27891, which is very specific to particle concentration measured by CPCs. And so this is a block diagram of the setup. You start with the aerosol generator with a conditioner and a neutralizer, which can be polonium 210 or soft X-ray in our case. The aerosol generator, we use the electro spray to generate the emery oil aerosol. And after it's neutralized, it goes through a differential mobility analyzer. And from there, it goes to a mixing device where you mix it with clean air to provide enough flow, and then to a flow splitter. And then you send the aerosol either both to the reference counting instruments, which can be Faraday cage aerosol electrometer or a reference CPC, and also to your dash CPC. In reality, this methodology was developed at the University of Minnesota in the 70s by Ben Liu and David Pui. And so the basis for this methodology dates back to University of Minnesota Particle Technology Laboratory. The requirements for the calibration aerosol is that it needs to be monodispersed, which is characterized by the geometric standard deviation, which needs to be under 1.1. This is typically done with the DMA. In the case of the standard we're using, it requires to use a DMA. when you use this technique, you need to make sure your fractional multiply charged particles is under 10%. As you can see in the curve below, you can see that the DMA, what it does, it takes a slice of the incoming aerosol size distribution coming from the electrospray. And depending on the location of the peak of that size distribution, you can get more or less multiply charged particles. And you can see in the curve, your main peak, this is for singly charged particles, and then a smaller peak, which needs to be combined with the 2 and 3 charges, less than 10%. So doubly charged particles and triple charged particles. This is important for ensuring better accuracy with the Faraday-cage electrometer, and still any small fraction multiple charged particles are corrected for in the final determination of the counting efficiency. The aerosol needs to be highly reproducible and stable, and no particle composition and a low vapor content. When it comes to traceability, the traceability needs to go back to national standard in SI units. And the most important one, of course, is the traceability of the reference electron meter or reference CPC. And in our case, our reference units are traceable to the UK National Laboratory, NPL. And obviously the flow meter also needs to be traceable to, in our case, it would be traceable to NIST. Please note that this standard 27891 does not define what the calibration aerosol needs to be, but in our case for engine source CPCs, the aerosol material is determined by or specified by PMP, and so it needs to be either emery oil or soot particles. So in summary, the ISO 27891 is very specific to calibration of particle counters. It gives you specific information on the setup, the requirements for the calibration aerosol characteristics, the procedure to do the calibrations, and the calculation methods used to determine the counting efficiency and the concentration accuracy. So this standard is pretty flexible, and so it can be tailored to different needs. And of course, for this specific application, this standard is tailored by the requirements of the PMP group. Here at DSI, we recently updated the way we're doing these CPCs in the process. We consolidated all the CPC, EECPC calibration services, which are available to all the models that go back to the initial 3790. So whether it's a 3790, 91, 92, or the more recent ones, 3790A-10, there are the same calibration procedures and materials that are used for ordering these calibrations. All these calibrations are compliant with the PMP requirements, and they all follow ISO 27891 for the procedure. And of course, these requirements are incorporated into European regulations that I mentioned before. Also applies to regulations in other countries like China 6 and other particle standards. And of course, we also are offering since last year also calibrations for 10 nanometer EECPCs, which will be required for upcoming Euro 7 regulations. I have a question here. How often does a CPC need to be calibrated? I think it needs to be calibrated at least once a year and verified at in the middle of the year at 6 months, either verified or change the week. This is the current requirement for this. So our standard EECPC calibrations are the ones that we've been offering for years. They're applicable either for 23 or 10 nanometers. And one important thing to emphasize here is that when we receive a CPC for calibration, before we actually do the calibration, we do the preventive maintenance. And that includes cleaning the nozzles and orifices, replacing internal filters, changing the wick, and even cleaning the optics to make sure that the instrument is performing well before we do the calibration. So this is something that is done with every CPC. So it's important to remember that it's when you talk about calibrating a CPC, you have to do proper maintenance before you actually do the calibration. If the CPC comes to us and is not working, then we would do a repair in addition to the clean and call service. There's a question, is there a formally released document that defines PMP calibration technical details? Yes, if you go to the GTR 15, it gives you the requirements for the calibrations and for the reference units and the calibration aerosol and everything that needs to be done is pretty well defined there. So, yes, go to the GTR 15 and you can see those requirements for the CPCs. Something new that we have now is we recently were accredited for ISO 17025. This is very specific to the EECPCs. And we are already accredited in the US and we're expecting to be accredited in the UK sometime this month. The difference between this and the standard calibrations is that the ISO 17025 has some additional requirements for quality control. You have to demonstrate that you can get accurate and partial test results. You have a higher quality of the technical calibration competence through the training of your technicians that do this work. We are also, we have to demonstrate intralaboratory and interlaboratory comparisons to make sure that when you do a calibration, it doesn't matter if you do it in our calibration center at in the UK or in the US that you get equivalent results. And we will be also doing comparisons with external facilities to make sure that you get the same calibration results. We also provide detailed evaluation of the uncertainty. And in the case of 17025 accredited calibrations, We also do a mandatory as found calibration and as left. In the standard calibrations, normally the as found is not done. We do the maintenance straight away and report the as left. But if you send us a CPC to do 17025 accredited calibration, then before we do maintenance, we do as found to see how the CPC is working. Then we do the maintenance and then they do the as left. Now, when it comes to the calibration itself, it follows basically the same procedure. So it's still compliant with PMP and we're still using ISO 17891 as the standard for the procedure used to do the calibration. There's a question here. Often should regular cleaning with CPC be performed? I think I mentioned this before. I think at the middle of the year, like 6 months, you could replace the wick, or you can do a verification against a reference CPC to verify that it's working correctly. The ISO 17025 calibrations are done to meet the demand of the automotive industry for higher quality control. And that's what the ISO 17025 gives you as international standard for calibration facilities. And so we are offering now this for all the EECPCs. Just a quick summary on measurement uncertainty, which is reported in the calibration certificates. Measurement uncertainty comes from several internal and external parameters. These are typical values for the uncertainties from multiple charging. Even though you do correction, there's uncertainty about 0.1%. The flow splitter bias is about 0.5%. The flow rate measurement is higher, is 2.7%. Test repeatability, which is based on repeated measurements at each point, is about 0.5%. The uncertainty of with respect to the reference counter is about 3%. And then external uncertainties, which are required to be included in the ISO 17025, include the operator uncertainty and any possible drift of the instrument during the before the between the previous calibration and the current calibration, and that's on the order of about 1%. The counting efficiency and the concentration measurements have different uncertainties. Typically, the uncertainties are a bit higher when you are doing the calibration on the sharp part of the efficiency curves. And then all these uncertainties are reported with a 95 confidence factor of K equal to. I'm going to stop a second to read a couple of questions. I already answered on the cleaning. We recommend doing the cleaning once a year. That's typically a good time to do the cleaning, and of course, the performance depends a little bit on the orifice and nozzle pressure values, but the performance is affected only when you are out of the typical ranges. So we recommend the cleaning yearly. There's a question about the calibration aerosol. as you know, for EECPCs, there is a small difference. Well, in general, for any CPC, the calibration aerosol can make a small difference in the counting efficiencies, particularly in the sharp part of the efficiency curve. So if you calibrate the CPC with emery oil and then you repeat the calibration with soot, you are not going to get exactly the same performance on the sharp part of the efficiency curve. So if you have a 50% cut point for emery oil, if you determine the 50% cut point for soot, I believe it's typically a little bit higher than for emery oil. So yes, there is some dependence on the material. That's why the material is specified by PMP. And for the case of PMP, it is recommended, it is required to use either emery oil or soot for the calibrations. This is a slide just showing our certificate of accreditation for ISO 17025. This is what we use here in the US for our service center in Shoreview. We're waiting to get the one in the UK by UCAS anytime now, but we are not accredited yet in the UK. We're expecting to be completed with the process by the end of this month. So for the standard services for EECPCs, as you can see, we consolidated them. So for 23 nanometers, we have the CL service is the standard, the CA is the accredited to 17025. And for the 10 nanometers, again, the CL with the dash 10 at the end is the standard calibration for 10 nanometers, and the CA is the same one with ISO 17025 accredited certificate. Now let's switch to reference counter calibrations. As you know, the calibration setup includes a reference counter, and that reference counter can be either an aerosol electrometer or a CPC. For aerosol electrometer, we recommend using the SETI 68B. And for the reference, it can be a SETI 772 or a SETI 750. If you want to get one today, it would have to be a SETI 750 that replaces the SETI 772. And we offer special calibrations for these reference counters. And the reason these calibrations are special is because they comply with the PMP requirements for the reference counters. But these calibrations for the reference counters are not ISO 17025 accredited. The electrometer calibrations, you need to have a detection efficiency of more than 95% for particles 5 nanometers or higher, and they need to have a reputable calibration certificate. And this certificate must use or report the charge concentration, as which can be calculated from the equation that is below. So we know we measure the flow rate, and you measure the current, so you can determine the charge concentration. This will be clear on the next slide. You can see typical detection efficiency. Of course, for fire cage electrometer, you don't expect to lose the ability to detect particles as you go down in size, and so that's the nice advantage of using fire cage electrometer, because you have nearly 100% efficiency all the way down to 5 nanometers. So you can see here that that detection efficiency, nearly one for different particle sizes. All these were done at 5,000 particles per cc. And then you can also look linearity of PSI electrometer against a reference electrometer. In this case, reference electrometer from, for example, UCAS or your national laboratory. And again, you can see nearly perfect linear correlation with slope 1.028 for this particular case. When you use a CPC for as a reference, of course, this CPC needs to have a cut that is smaller than the cut of the EECPC. So reference CPCs can be used, for example, to calibrate 23 nanometer EECPCs. And so, for example, in this case, you can see in this calibration curve that the 50% detection efficiency of this CPC is below 10 nanometers, is about 7 nanometers, okay? And you can see also that when you get to 23 nanometers, now you are at nearly 100% counting efficiency. Now, it's important to notice that these performance or calibration curve depends somewhat on particle material shape. So it's important to have your reference CPC calibrated with the same aerosol that you're trying to calibrate your EECPCs with. So for the 23 nanometer EECPCs, you can use a 3750 CPC. There is a question here. If the cyclone separation efficiency accounting for, let's see, like measurement uncertainty calculations. No, we're talking here about calibration only of the CPC, not of the complete system, the solid particle counting system. So we're only addressing here the performance of the CPC alone. And so the cyclone doesn't come into play here. The cyclone may play a role in the performance of the complete system because it removes large particles. But in any case, I would expect that the cyclone would not affect the CPC calibration. Because the cyclone only removes very large particles. So when you're calibrating the CPC, you don't get any large particles. So even if you had a cyclone there, it probably wouldn't do anything. So in this case, you can see a linearity curve for 3772. Very similar to the ones for EECPC, and you have a K factor of 1.03 measured with 55 nanometer particles, and the counting efficiency also is measured. I don't have the curve here, but basically for this particular CPC, you had a 95% counting efficiency at 23 nanometers. So meeting the requirements for a reference CPC. So basically for reference encounters, we're offering these special PMP calibrations, which are on this table, and I'd like to emphasize that these special PMP calibrations for reference counters are different from the standard calibrations that we offer for the for these counters. So if you want to use one of these instruments, a reference counter in a calibration system which is compliant with the PMP requirements to verify or calibrate other EECPCs, you will need to have this special PMP calibration from TSI. So, which is available for the 3750 CPC that has a cut of 7 nanometers. That's a 50% deficiency. Or a 3068B, which is the 5K electrometer, you would need to order the CL3068B PMP, which has the proper counting efficiency and linearity measurements that are done in this calibration. So with that, we get to a summary. The accuracy and reproducibility of PM measurement really relies on having optimum CPC performance. And therefore, these CPCs need to have proper preventive maintenance, which includes replacing the internal wick, the filters, cleaning the nozzles, and then doing a reputable calibration, which means that it's a traceable calibration to a national standard using a procedure that is, in this case, backed by ISO standard and keeping all the requirements that PMP gives for the CPC calibrations. So our calibrations all are PMP compliant, and all of them follow ISO 27891. And if you order the 17025, which is high level of quality control, we include these calibrations include as found as left, and of course stated measurement certainties a little bit differently from the previous the standard calibrations, because in the ISO 17025 we also take into account or report external uncertainties. And finally, we can also do calibration of reference counters for calibration benches. However, these calibrations are fully traceable. They are fully traceable to NPL in our case, but they are not ISO 17025 for the reference counters. So with that, I really thank you for your participation today, for attending the webinar. We'll be here answering questions. I have with me also Justin Kosak, who is an application engineer at TSI, and he can also help answering questions. So feel free to keep adding questions to the question and answer section, and we can answer them accordingly if we know the specific answers. If not, we'll get back to you via email. There's a specific question here. Can we use a 3750 as a reference for calibrating a CPC 3790-10? I don't think you can use it, because the 3750 has a cut point of 7 nanometers. And so I don't know the exact number for the counter efficiency at 10 nanometers, but it's probably not high enough. I will have to double check on that, but we at TSI, when we do a 10 nanometer EECPC calibration, we use the electrometer as the reference. We don't use a 3750. We do use equivalent to a 3750 for the 23 nanometer calibrations, but not for the 10 nanometer ones. Can you please discuss the normalized plateau correlation in the slides back? This is, we don't use this really. I mean, that normalized part, it really brings the counter efficiency to exactly 100% at the plateau section, but we all know that that CPCs are not perfect, and the counter efficiency when you get to the flat part of the curve, it's close to 100%, but it's not exactly 100%. It's somewhere typically higher than 95, so it's 97-98%. And so that is used on the calculations. So the normalized efficiency curve is not really used, even though it was shown on the plot. We use the actual calibration curve for the reference CPC. If you have a CPC, the question is if you have a CPC that has only 90% efficiency at the plateau, it needs to be recalibrated. I think it indicates that something is affecting the performance, because typically when we calibrate EECPCs, the requirement is that at the second particle size, which is 41 nanometers for the 23 nanometer CPCs, it needs to be higher than 90. So internally at DSI, we require it to be 90, at least 92%. So yes, I would say yes, you need to check on that, because if it's only 90%, you are already at 10% below, which wouldn't meet the requirements. Is a higher or lower K factor better? The closer to one is the better. And so there's a requirement. This calibration factor has to be between 0.9 and 1. So typically it's a little bit higher than 1, because typically what you find is that the efficiency is a little bit below 100%. So the K factor is higher than 1, normally a little bit higher than 1. If it's one, very close to one, it's even better, because then it has perfect agreement with your reference counter. Does TSI provide on-site calibration services? I don't believe we do that, because it requires a very, very specific experimental setup. So that's what we're offering. Calibration services in the UK, in Aachen, in Germany, and in the US. And I believe we're also starting to do this in China. You show a graph of detection efficiency of electrometer. How do you calculate the detection efficiency exactly? Well, in reality, the electrometer shouldn't have size dependence. And so the curve that I showed, compare TSI electrometer response with respect to another electrometer that has been calibrated by a national lab. And so ideally, you expect a counting efficiency of 100% at all the points that you calibrate, but in reality, even when you compare two electrometers, you don't get a perfect agreement between of them. So, but you should expect a counting efficiency of the order of 1 or 100%. So basically, the way it's calculated in the plot that I showed is the ratio between the counting efficiency of the CPC, the electrometer being calibrated against the reference electrometer. So, but in principle, from a theoretical point of view, they should agree and be very close to 100%. And yes, and when we do this, what I showed is a test with actual particles. Because remember the electrometer, when I say electrometer, really is a Faraday cage electrometer. So it's not just electrometer. We're not just measuring the current, but we are collecting the particles with the Faraday cage electrometer. So we're collecting the particles inside the fire cage with a filter, and then we're measuring the charge of the particles that are collected inside the electrometer. So yes, this calibration is with particles. We're not just testing the electrometer part of the instrument, which would be would only require calibration of the current. We are actually doing a calibration with particles, because that's what we care about, is the ability to measure the charge carried by the particles. Feel free, you will be getting the presentation. And so feel free to send more questions via email. My email is in the first slide, so I'll be happy to answer additional questions if you don't come up with any right now. There's a follow-up question here, but you don't correct your reference emitter with side-dependent efficiency. No, but you do correct it with your average factor with respect to the reference, you know, the standard reference electrometer. So in the example that I showed, there is a slight difference between the electrometer being calibrated and the reference one. So you should take into account that in your when you use the calibrated electrometer. I hope that's clear, but if not, I mean, we can keep the conversation outside of the webinar. I'll be glad to talk to you about that. Yes, is an upgrade from a 23 nanometer to 10 nanometer possible? Yes, of course, absolutely. We can do it. In fact, you can send to us a 23 nanometer. And if you order the 10 nanometer, it will be converted to 10 nanometers. But once it's converted, it'll be operating at conditions for 10 nanometer detection. So you, at that point, there's no way to go back to 23 nanometers unless you calibrate it one more time and change the setting so it can operate at 23 nanometers. So in reality, the main difference between a 23 and 10 nanometer CPC is the operating conditions, but the same hardware for the most part can be used. Of course, there are some adjustments that you may have to do to the laser power and the pulse height, but other than that, I mean, the same hardware can be used, and that's why it's possible to take a 23 nanometer CPC and upgrade it to 10 nanometers. because it's mostly a change in the operating conditions. I think there's also a small difference in the orifice to maintain the flow rate, but other than that, it's pretty much the same hardware. So it is possible to upgrade the 23 nanometer EECPC to 10 nanometers.
So we're coming to the end of the hour. I really appreciate all your questions and thank you for attending the webinar. And feel free to contact me via email or your sales rep from TSI if you have specific questions with regards to our EECPCs. We're here to help you achieve your goals and do assist you any way we can so that you can use these CPCs on their optimum operating conditions and performance. So again, thank you for your participation. There's one last question here. How to make sure that shipping won't impair calibration performance? You can do a quick check on site. Yes, yeah, it's possible to do a quick check on site either against the best way would be to do it against another CPC. But there are easy things that can be done. We have service cards that tell you how to do a zero check and how to do a check at a specific concentration. So it is possible. So we're running out of time. I will try to answer to your questions, any additional questions via email separately. Can we use a 3482 as a generator for CPC calibration? I forgot what a 3482 is. If it's a
3482 is the electrospray, Francisco.
It's the electrospray, okay. So the electrospray, yes, it could be any, and yes, it can. I mean, there's some specific requirements for injecting the CPC, the emery oil, but yes, it can be used. How long does it take service? I'm not 100% sure. I believe is on the order of 2 to 4 weeks. But I don't know the exact answer to that. I don't know how long it really takes. Justin, you know?
No, it varies depending on our workload. But if you are in need of a calibration, if you reach out to your sales manager or representative, we can get a more accurate estimate for you of how long it would take.
I think the goal is to do it in 2 weeks. So, I'm not sure how successful we are in keeping that time. I guess it really depends on the on the workload that the service center has.
Again, thank you so much for attending, and I hope this was useful. You'll be getting the presentation materials via email, I believe. Thank you.